Tonight, ISIS is maintaining control of the city of Palmyra in Syria. Now, we're learning more about how ISIS is treating the people of Palmyra. For some insight, we're joined via Skype from Istanbul by Anne Barnard of the New York Times. So, this was the first city that ISIS took control over from the Syrian government. Have their tactics changed and what they do when they get into town?
Well, it seems there's a certain set of steps that ISIS has honed during the 2 years that it started to accumulate territory in Iraq and Syria. They come in, they carry out some well-publicized atrocities, beheadings, attacking people who they think might oppose them, and trying to court favor with some other populations, and alternating between the two. Now, this is the first time that they've taken a town from the government and not from insurgents who had taken it previously. So, strangely, here, they don't expect to have a rival for the anti-government mantle, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Some people are surprised that they have not been harsher with the general population, especially because Palmyra is a place that made its living off the tourist trade and was quite open with the West.
So in your reporting, you say besides the atrocities and the beheadings and the executions and so forth, they're also trying to take on municipal matters, turning on the water and the fuel.
Yes, well, one of their goals is to convince people that they really are a state and that they bring administration, that they can take over institutions and facilities and provide services. So within hours of coming into town, they had executed people publicly in the streets, and at the same time, they were trying to carry out very ordinary functions, opening the bakery, giving bread for free, and fixing the power plant and the water pumps, which had been left not working by the retreating soldiers. At the same time, bombing started, so the services have been coming in and out.
The people of Palmyra are caught in a bit of between a rock and a hard place. On the one hand, if they don't cooperate with ISIS, they could meet with death. And then on the other hand, really, it's the government that they don't feel a tremendous loyalty to anyway.
Yeah, I mean, like everywhere in Syria, and I visited Palmyra a year ago, so we got to know a lot of people there. There's certainly a range of sentiment about the government, from pro to anti. But Palmyra was a place where there was a local rebellion that was put down in 2012. It's an almost entirely Sunni town where the security forces had never felt extremely comfortable, especially those that were from other parts of the country. They told us a year ago that they felt that the people, they couldn't trust the local people. So there definitely was anti-government sentiment there.
Is there a feeling among some of the people on the ground that ISIS could be a viable alternative to the Syrian government?
Well, I asked a guy who is a longtime anti-government activist there. He doesn't really like ISIS. He has some relatives who are in ISIS. He said that he was remaining opposed to both ISIS and the government. He said, you know, people don't really have a choice. They came into town and it was imposed upon them.
Are the airstrikes by the Syrian government making the Islamic State's case for them?
Well, yes. People were very afraid of ISIS when they came in, and their main focus was the executions in the streets and whether they were going to treat the population harshly. Now there's nearly daily airstrikes. People are reporting having lost friends in these airstrikes, including government employees, people that might have been pro-government. You know, I think now people's immediate source of fear and worry has shifted from the militants on the ground to the warplanes that are overhead. But at the same time, they're keeping an eye on whether ISIS will start to apply some of its harsh practices to the general population.
All right. Anne Barnard of the New York Times joining us via Skype from Istanbul. Thanks so much.
Thank you.